From the Nile and the Euphrates flowed knowledge of an art on which so many other arts are based. From the Fertile Crescent up to Greece, mathematics began to flow. Sometime in the 6th century BCE, the great geometer Pythagoras of Samos went to Egypt. He returned even more fascinated with geometrical ideas than he had been when he had left. He knew there was wisdom and possibilities he had to share. But geometry wasn't the only thing that fascinated him. He saw geometry as part of a larger whole, part of a philosophy about the perfection of the universe. He needed to share this too, and he knew how to do it. Through geometry. He envisioned the study of geometry as one of the disciplines that would lead a human being to be more in touch with the true perfection of the universe. So he went to Magna Graecia, the Greek colonies in what we would now call Italy, and set up a mystery cult to study philosophy and practice the sacred art of geometry. And his cult did great until they were chased out of Magna Graecia for their anti-democratic views. But the thing about mystery cults is, well, they like their mysteries, so they're not always great at, you know, writing a bunch of stuff down. Thus, while the Pythagoreans taught and shared their knowledge, and weren't nearly as secretive as most of these groups, they were more interested in the philosophy of Pythagoras and the ways mathematics pointed to a beautiful perfection underlying the universe than they were in providing a unified mathematical system. So, enter Euclid, a figure we know surprisingly little about, but whose work had a nearly indescribable impact on human history. Euclid wrote a book, or rather, in the parlance of the time, 13 books, called The Elements. For over 2,000 years, this work would stand as the height of logical rigor. This book right here is the root of almost all mathematics. Modern geometry, algebra, calculus, all of them founded in this work. To this day, it is the second most republished work in history after the Bible. In this book, Euclid brought together all of the geometric knowledge of the ancient world, transcribing the discoveries of the Pythagoreans and others, and extending them, adding his own proofs and discoveries to this great catalog of the known. But what makes this work truly one of the pinnacles of human achievement is how he put it together, how it was organized. Because the book begins with a small number of definitions, postulates, and common notions, and says that with those, everything else, every single thing in geometry, follows logically. He then organizes his proofs, the various geometric problems he presents, so that they all build off of one another. No proof in the entire book will require knowledge beyond those initial definitions and the proofs that came before it. It is a wholly self-contained system, entirely logically consistent, showing just how far we can go with a few simple ideas. The Elements is the foundation of mathematical thinking, and in a lot of ways, the foundation for how we think of logic today. It was a huge achievement. But there was one small issue that bothered some of those studying this text, an issue that appears to have bothered even Euclid himself, and that was the fifth postulate. Most of the postulates in the book are fairly simple and straightforward. They say things like, you can draw a straight line between any two points, or all right angles are equal. But the fifth postulate is not simple in the slightest. It's more complex and it just feels different than any of the rest. How complex is it? Well, the fifth postulate states, quote, if a straight line falling across two straight lines makes internal angles on the same side less than two right angles, the two straight lines, if produced indefinitely, meet on that side on which are the angles less than two right angles. Gugh, that felt gross to say. Feels a lot messier than all right angles are equal to one another, right? So let's just break it down real quick. A straight line falling across two straight lines, okay, that's just a line crossed by two other lines somewhere, makes internal angles on the same side less than two right angles. And this is basically saying if the internal or interior angles, these angles which face each other right here, made by the two lines crossing that third line add up to less than two right angles, or 180 degrees, then the two straight lines, if produced indefinitely, meet on the side where the angles are less than two right angles. So, okay, if that thing I said about the interior angles before is true, then if you extend those two lines forever, they are going to intersect at some point on the side where the interior angles are less than right angles. So, putting all that together, if you draw a line and you have two other lines cross it, if their interior angles add up to less than 180 degrees, those lines are eventually going to intersect if you draw them out far enough. Or, put even more simply, lines angled towards each other are going to intersect if you draw them out far enough. And when you put it that way, it actually seems kinda obvious, right? In fact, we are so used to that concept that it barely even seems worth enunciating, but Euclid was nothing if not thorough. And hidden in this concept is another all-important one. Because let's look at those two lines crossing the third line again. What are the possibilities here? Well, if their interior angles on a side are less than 180 degrees, we already know they are going to meet. But what if they are greater than 180 degrees? Well, then the interior angles on the other side are going to be less than 180 degrees, right? So they're just going to intersect on that side. It's basically the same thing, just flipped around. But what happens if the two angles add up to exactly 180 degrees? Well, then, by this schema, those lines would never meet. What this postulate actually does is define what we today call parallel lines. But we know that this postulate was a problem, even for Euclid. It's the last postulate he puts in the book, and even after he's enunciated it, he goes about proving almost every single thing that can be proven in geometry without it, before at last relying on postulate 5 to build the rest of what we think of as standard geometry today. And he wasn't alone in being bothered by postulate 5's weirdness. For over 2,000 years, postulate 5 would bug people. It feels like it should be a proposition, not a postulate. It feels like there should be a logical proof for it. And if we could make such a proof, then all of geometry truly would be consistent. The last lingering question would be answered, and we really would have that beautiful system that the Pythagoreans desired so much. But if Euclid couldn't find a solution to postulate 5, who could? Find out next time as we explore all the ways people built off of Euclid, and all the different attempts people made to reconcile this one last tiny piece of our perfect geometry.